Welcome to Senior Circuit. We're so glad to have you. Thank you so much for joining us. This is Lead Prevention Awareness Month, and we have a great guest with us today, Daniel Hauck. Mm-hmm. And Daniel, tell us a little bit about yourself and a little bit about Lead Prevention Week.
All right, thank you so much for having me.
You're
so
welcome.
My name is Daniel. I've worked with the city now for almost 6 years. I can't believe it. The
wow.
time flies. I know, right?
Yeah.
I'm currently the Lead Program, the Somerville Lead Abatement Program Manager. And we manage over $4 million in federal funds that help low-income families with children get rid of lead paint in their houses. So it's a great program, and this is a perfect time for me to be on here because it's National Lead Poisoning Awareness Month. So particularly in places like New England, where we have a lot of old houses, this is a really important time. And I don't know if people are familiar, but lead paint was made illegal in 1978. So prior to that, everything that we used in our windows, all of our paint, all of our pipes, everything had lead paint, or just lead in general. So it's a really big issue in New England. And so we're doing, so along with the show and many other things, we're trying to get the word out there that lead is still a serious issue, particularly in places like Somerville, where all the housing is so old. And so we want to make sure that people know that we have funding available to help them make their houses lead safe. So
in a typical home here in Somerville, somebody may not even know that they have lead paint.
Absolutely.
Or why it's so hazardous.
Absolutely.
Tell me that.
It's a big deal. So 85% of Somerville was built before 1948, which means that over 90% of Somerville's housing stock has lead paint in it. It may have been rehabbed, you don't really know, but it's better to assume, to be perfectly frank, in Somerville that if your house is old, then you do have lead paint. Now, what that does to you, children are more susceptible to it. Children 6 and under are very susceptible to lead poisoning. And lead poisoning can lead to decreased mental ability, serious behavioral problems, serious health problems with your lungs and your heart. It can overall be very, very damaging. Again, that's mostly for children, but adults are as well can be seriously injured by lead paint as it builds up in their system. When you look at your house, where is most of the lead paint, right? What do you think are major hazards? You'd be surprised if you have an old window has lead in it. And every time you open it and close it, it creates lead dust. And that dust gets in your lungs, and that is what accumulates in your system and creates lead poisoning. Also, chipping paint. So if you have paint chipping on your walls and it is old, the paint underneath, or the original will probably have lead paint. So when you look at your house, things that move, like doors and windows, are really important and tend to create a lot of lead dust, which is an issue. And then any flaking paint, both interior and exterior, can also be serious issues and lead to lead poisoning. So
it's funny, we had this discussion sitting around having coffee the other morning at the health fair, and one of the things we were talking about was, Mrs. Jones said, well, I have like 5 layers of wallpaper
right.
over the paint.
Right.
So it's protected. And just because my windows are chipping, I don't have children around, so they don't eat it
right.
because it's sweet, so they like to eat it.
Right.
So no children, no lead paint, it doesn't bother anybody. And 6 layers of wallpaper. Is that true?
If there's wallpaper covering the paint, then yes, that is true. The lead will not be seeping through. That won't cause an issue. If you have older windows and they're moving, no matter what you do, whether you eat the paint or not, that dust is an issue. But they do talk about, yes, the peeling paint and eating paint chips is the quintessential, that's how you get lead poisoning. But it's a lot more than that. The main culprit nowadays is dust.
Dust.
So that's something to really keep in mind, particularly when you're opening your doors and windows, you know?
And what about the person that might say to you, well, my children only visit once in a blue moon.
Right. I would say if your child visits you even up to 60 hours a year, that the HUD, the federal government, considers that to be enough time to create some serious issues and possible lead poisoning. So if you take care of your grandkids once every couple of weekends. That's enough to seriously injure them. And that's not to mention the accumulation in your own system, of the possible accumulation of lead in your own system. So if they only visit every once in a while, that doesn't mean that they're safe.
Because it's a myth that only children get lead poisoning.
That's correct. It's a huge myth. They found more recently, they don't track it as well, but they found more recently that actually there are significant amounts of senior citizens who have been living in homes with lead paint for a long time, that therefore they have a lead buildup and they don't even realize it, because we don't test ourselves for lead paint. It's not something we think about. Oh, I may have lead poisoning. That's not, but it is true.
So I know we're going to talk a little bit about eligibility, but tell me about your program and what it has to offer from seniors to family.
Absolutely. So our program offers zero interest forgivable loans, which means that you don't ever have to pay it back. It's a three-year loan, which means at the end of those 3 years, the loan is completely forgiven if you maintain compliance. Now, the two parts of compliance are keeping the house lead safe. So once the work is done, you must maintain it. So basically, it's just continual upkeep of your property to make sure there's no chipping paint or anything. And the other is if you live in the property, you must continue to live in the property for those 3 years of the loan. Or if you rent the property, then you must comply with our rental restrictions, which we're actually now working at this time to change them, to increase them, because as we know, rents are more expensive in Somerville nowadays, so you can get more for a two-bedroom unit. So we're trying to increase our rent limits to make it more attractive to homeowners who have units for rent. So once you qualify, which is all that eligibility, the program will pay for everything. It will pay for the lead inspection. It will pay to relocate your tenants. It will pay for all of those things. You as a homeowner would have to pay for the lead inspection, and our program would reimburse you for it. We'd go out, we'd create work specifications, we'd get bids for the program. Once you get those bids, we sign documents for the loan, and then the city will pay your contractor. It never has to come out of your pocket. And then we will pay for the final inspection to get what's called your letter of compliance, which means your house is lead safe. You pay for it, we will reimburse you. The only costs that ever come out of pocket that don't get reimbursed are filing fees to the state of Massachusetts, $175 in the beginning and $75 at the end. Otherwise, you pay nothing.
That's incredible.
It's amazing.
And it sounds a little bit that it's a little bit of work, but technically, if you qualify under the guidelines, you live in your home,
yep,
you stay there for 3 years,
yep,
or rent to somebody who's eligible to live there,
mm-hmm,
the city has given you that loan for nothing.
Nothing.
Or $225.
$250
total. Okay, yeah. So what's $25?
I know, and nothing. And when you're talking about thousands, tens of thousands
of
dollars.
That's amazing.
It's a really amazing program, and we have a lot more flexibility than some other programs. For instance, if you have a vacant unit, so say your kid was living downstairs and they're no longer living there and you haven't rented it out, You can sign what's called an affirmative marketing policy that says that you're going to look for families with children to rent in that space, and that automatically qualifies you for the program. You don't even have to go through any of the documentation, because we do require some documentation. The federal government needs to make sure that people are income eligible. But if you have a vacant unit, it automatically qualifies you for our program once you sign the affirmative marketing policy. So it makes it simple. Now, in the beginning, it's a little bit more labor intensive getting all the documents together, making sure you have all that stuff. It's difficult. Our staff is really great at working through it. We know exactly what you need, and we're there holding your hand the whole way if that's necessary. But really, once you get past that part, it's almost painless at that point in time,
That's incredible.
Yeah.
We'll be right back and talk about this very exciting topic, but this is when you get your paper and pencil and look at all the great things that we have going on.
In the misty moonlight, by the flickering firelight, any place is all right, long as I'm with you.
As long as I'm with you.
In a faraway land, on a tropic sea sand, if your hand's in my hand, I won't be blue. Way up on a mountain, way down in a valley, I know I'll be happy any place, anywhere. I don't care in the misty moonlight, by the flickering firelight, any place is all right, long as you are there.
Welcome back. Great things we have going on. It's the holiday season. I can't believe we're talking about December and January, and it's only October. Well, it's the middle of October. But great things coming up. You don't want to miss all those great holiday parties and the Thanksgiving dinner. We're so excited about the mayor's event that he'll be having on November 15th. A wonderful Thanksgiving dinner. So if you haven't signed up, please make sure that you call Connie and do sign up. So we're here with Daniel, and we're talking about lead poisoning, and it's a great topic. I'm really excited about it. One question I will guarantee that you'll get from the seniors is, when I give you all my information, how many other people in the city are going to see it?
Yes, we get that question from everybody, because we do ask for some sensitive information, bank statements, things of that nature. So the information is seen by myself and my intake coordinator. And then once you are qualified for the program, it's not shared with anybody else in the city beyond my staff and myself. And then once because it's a 3-year loan. So we monitor the rent throughout the 3 years. At that point in time, our financial staff in the housing division sees the information, and then after 5 years, it's destroyed, and it just stays with our files. It's under lock and key every day, all the time. So it really is only seen by 3 people in the entire city, and all of them work with my program. So.
And another thing, what about my tenant? Mm-hmm. Will my tenant have to give you all kinds of information, and will they see my stuff?
So that depends. If it all depends on whether or not if you own a property and you don't live in it, then your tenants will have to qualify you. So yes, they will have to submit the same documentation that you would. But if you qualify, for instance, and you live in a 2-family home, we don't need any of your financial information from your tenant, and because you qualify. But at no time do we share any information about your property, your personal information, anything about a mortgage if it exists. We share none of that with a tenant. We share none of that with any contractors. We share none of that with anybody but our staff to make sure that you're income eligible.
And it's something that we talked about a little bit earlier that I wanted to touch on. I know that a lot of seniors have apartments that are empty.
Right.
They don't want to share that apartment.
Right.
Because they might have had a bad tenant, things weren't really well, you know, they don't want noisy children. You know, there's all kinds of reasons why.
Right.
And or they're just afraid of who they're going to rent to.
You never know.
You never know. However, this is a perfect opportunity for them to work with you to be able to have an apartment that is lead safe, that's a good word.
Mm-hmm.
And then think about having a tenant.
Correct.
Now, do you lead tenants to them, or how do they go about getting tenants, and what type of tenants do they have to have?
So the document that we talked about was the affirmative marketing policy. It's directly geared towards marketing in general. So say you have this empty unit and we qualify you with this program, you have to offer the unit. When you do advertising for it, you have to specifically state that this unit is a lead-safe unit available for families with children. There's a couple of numbers that we give you to call. If someone comes to us and we know of a vacant unit, we will refer, we will offer the client with the vacant unit the opportunity of a referral. We don't automatically refer people without their permission.
So you don't place anybody in that
no,
unit?
No, no,
and
no.
And I think that may be something that might make
correct.
You nervous.
We
right?
don't. We don't force anybody to take a tenant that they don't want to. Definitely not. And then in the same token, if they do, you know, if they go through the program and they have a vacant unit and they choose not to rent it afterwards, that's fine as well. As long as if they do choose to put it on the market, they make sure that they make it available to families with children. But we have multiple contacts for that they can reach out to if they're looking for a tenant to fill a vacant unit that is lead safe.
And what happens if myself or my tenant isn't financially available for lead safe?
Right. So our program has very specific and strict rent income limits. So for instance, a family of three, you'd have to make less than $52,000. So it's sometimes difficult to find yourself income eligible. If you work with us and we find that you're not income eligible, the state has a program, it's called the Get the Lead Out program. The income limits are a little bit higher, but unfortunately the loan isn't so sweet. You have to pay it back and there's small amounts of interest involved. But the rent limits are much higher. So Just a Start Corporation is a local corporation, and they are actually the local administrators of the Get the Lead Out program. Mm-hmm. So if you come to us and we can't get you eligible for the program, then we can refer you to them if you want to continue to move forward with it. So.
This is such good information. It really is. And I think there's a lot of folks out there in the audience that probably weren't aware of all these programs that are available
Absolutely.
For them. So I'm glad that you're here sharing that. I do want to take a break right now and go to a wonderful fair that we had, some blood testing and some flu shots and some great folks that came out. We had over 250 seniors that came out to the Council on Aging for a health fair. We'll be right back. So good morning. Welcome to our health fair. We're so glad to have you here today. We have lots of great folks out today. We have Windsor House, and Assisted Livings, V&A. We have Minuteman, Shine. We have Cambridge Health Alliance, who's a great supporter. Somerville Cambridge Elder Service, who's a great partner with us. We're so pleased that they supported us here today. Lots of different interesting things. We have flu shots going on. It's really crazy today, but we love it. Lots of buzz in the air. Somerville Cambridge Elder Services are partners with us in many things, but especially here with our health fair today. So Erica, tell me what you're doing here today.
Well, we wanted to provide information for people in the community about some of the programs that we provide related to health and wellness, as well as the resources that we can be to people in their homes and in the community.
And Erica, tell me, what do you do at Somerville Cambridge Elder Services?
I work in the Aging Information Department.
And what does the Aging Information do?
We take all the calls. We provide information about resources in the community and outside of the community. We want to make sure that people are getting the information that they need and that would help benefit them.
Great. And tell us, how does somebody reach you?
They can give us a call. That's usually the easiest way. 617-628-2601. And someone is always there to answer or respond to questions and inquiries.
We're here with David Hudson from Shape Up Somerville. And David, tell us what you're doing here today.
So we're promoting tap water. We have a new grant to promote tap water over bottled water. So we're asking people to complete this survey here. The questions are, how often do you drink bottled water? What concerns do you have about bottled water? And what needs to be done in Somerville to increase tap water consumption? So we're really trying to get the message out to people that it's perfectly safe to drink tap water. Our water comes from the Quabbin Reservoir from the MWRA. It's obviously less costly to drink tap water, and it's better for the environment.
I love Somerville's water. It's the best water around. And wasn't that proven somewhere? Didn't we do a survey that it said Somerville had the best tap water around?
Yes, that was done in Boston, actually. And we've been doing tap water tastings, which the Cambridge Health Alliance is doing right next to me. So trying to get people to taste tap water over bottled water to see which they actually prefer.
We're here with Lisa Brugolaccio, and we're tasting the water from Somerville. We just saw that Shape Up Somerville is doing a survey.
I'm here as part of the Somerville Community Health Agenda, as part of a coalition that's looking at how we can sort of challenge myths and perceptions about tap water. This issue that was raised by one of the doctors at CHA who had concern for patients coming in with these tiny little bottles of water that they were paying $5 for because they were being told this is good. And it turned out that a lot of other people were interested. You've already talked to David from Shape Up Somerville, SCAT TV's gotten involved, the MWRA themselves, because one of the things we wanted to do is particularly do outreach to non-English speaking and or immigrant populations in Somerville, which we have a lot, because if you come from somewhere else in the country, you might not reasonably expect that it's safe to drink the tap water. So we're really trying to challenge people's beliefs and sort of knowledge and show them that the water in our area comes from the Quabbin Reservoir, which is a beautiful, pristine reservoir out in Western Mass, and that it gets lots of treatment on its way to us, and it's stringently tested and regulated, much more so than bottled water. And it traditionally, the Boston area water gets one of the top 10 best tasting waters in the country.
My name's Ashley. I'm the program director at Sancta Maria's Windsor House. We're an adult day health center, and we service people who have mental health, cognitive disabilities, pretty much anybody who needs supervision, they come to us. We have a nurse on site all the time, social worker, everything.
And what's a great way for somebody, a caregiver, a loved one who needs help with their folks during the day, has some questions, concerned, how do I pay for it, how do I get there, what do I do, how long can they stay? Who answers those questions and how do they get in touch with you?
So they would just call one of the centers, or we do have a referral line that people can call. They would speak with our social workers or any of the program directors at the center, and anybody would really be able to help them through and explain more of the admission process.
And tell me, what's a good number for somebody to reach you on that referral line?
617-491-1815.
So thank you so much for joining us at the Health Fair today. We look forward to seeing you in the future Health Fairs, and let's get back to the show.
Wasn't that great? We had so much fun. There was great food, great gifts that day, great topics. We had so many people come out and had, I think we gave over 100 flu shots.
Wow.
We had glucose testing, cholesterol screening,
wow,
weight management, exercise, frailty tests. We had some great sponsors, Cambridge Health Alliance. We had Shape Up Somerville there. We were tasting Somerville's water, Somerville water rocks. It's the best. We won the taste test. It was fabulous.
That's great.
But we look forward to having you again next year. So I'm here with Daniel, and Daniel is with the LEAD program here in Somerville. And Daniel, the big question, how do I get a contractor and how do I know they work?
Right, I know. It's so scary because these people are going to be in your house for a while. They're going to be doing a lot of work and you want to be able to trust them. So there's a couple of things that we offer. We have what's called a contractor selection book.
Mm-hmm.
So anybody that's gone through our program, at the end, we give them, basically it's an evaluation sheet. How did we do? How did your contractor do? What were the good things about the contractor? And they rate them and then we put that in that book. So we not only do we have a list of contractors that keep in-house, but many of them have a lot of past recommendations from clients. So once we get to that point where we need to get some bids on the project, we offer that to you, to the client, to sit down, take a look at it, see what these people had to say about contractors. Now, if you choose a contractor that you are comfortable with, that you've worked with in the past, that's totally fine with us, as long as they are licensed to do lead abatement work, and we get a copy of that license and a copy of their insurance. So if you have someone that you know that you feel comfortable with, feel free to get them to bid. As long as we have the documentation, then we'll go with anybody. But what we really want is to make sure that you feel comfortable with your contractor, because they're going to be doing a lot of work with you. So, and also with that, when we do the payments, they're structured in segments, and we keep a last payment of a few thousand dollars there, sort of like a security blanket. So if you have an issue with your contractor along the way and something is not right and it's not done to your satisfaction, we don't process that final check for $3,000, $5,000, which can be a lot of money to a contractor.
Absolutely.
So it's your security net mm-hmm. as a homeowner and our security net as a program to make sure that everything gets done properly and to everybody's satisfaction.
And the part I like about that is they don't feel pressured, because you know that contractor gets in there. I'm working on a case right now where a senior gave all the money up, but the work's not done.
Right.
So, you know, but they felt bullied, pressured into giving that money.
Right.
Well, they're not gonna pressure you guys because
nope.
you're the city.
Yeah.
So, now one quick thing you said earlier in the conversation, when you get the contractor and you're getting
uh-huh.
the work done, it pays to displace the tenant.
Correct.
What about the owner?
So this is what HUD says. Because the homeowner is getting such a significant investment in their property mm-hmm. of thousands and thousands of dollars, we cannot reimburse them for relocation. But we can reimburse tenants. So that's not only for the hotel costs, because everybody, lead is a poison, so you cannot be living on the premises when the work is done. So you do have to be relocated. But we'll pay for hotels, we'll pay for food, we'll pay for packing materials, we'll pay for all of that. Unfortunately, we can't do that for the homeowner.
Okay, so the homeowner's on herself.
Homeowner is on himself.
Okay.
Is herself, correct.
Start to finish,
mm-hmm.
how long is it gonna take? How long am I gonna be displaced?
So start to finish, meaning you get program information. There's the two parts that take the most time are becoming eligible for the program, so the income certification point, and then sometimes the bidding can take a little bit of time. But I say we don't really have projects that last, meaning you're outside of your house for more than 5 to 7 days max. The average,
wow.
The average is like 2 to 5 days, sometimes even less. If it's a single family home, obviously it's gonna be a little bit more time because mm-hmm. there's a lot to do.
It's a lot to
do. You know, but in 2 or 3 family homes where each unit is individual, there's not as much work. It's not as time consuming, therefore we can get it done in about a week. So say you have a 3 family, I'd say an average of 3 weeks for the interior and a week for the exterior to actually get the work done. So mm-hmm. about 4 to 5 weeks for 3 family structures for the actual work to be completed mm-hmm. is a fair estimate. Now, when you include the application and getting the bids and things like that, the average is between 3 and 4 months total from start to finish. But the actual work is right around a month.
That's amazing. I expect it to be much, much longer than that. So the hard part is sitting down and doing all the paperwork
getting
all that done.
Most of the legwork is in the beginning.
Right.
And, you know, and we found that that's a struggle as well. And so we tried to really streamline it and make it simpler for homeowners to do this. So we have a lot of documents. If it's necessary, we will, again, work with you as much as possible. One of the things they do require is 3 months of consecutive pay stubs. Sometimes it's really hard to collect, so particularly from your tenants, right?
Right.
So one of the things that we've done, it is a form letter that we've created that your tenant can give to their
employer
and say, this person makes X amount of money, which makes it significantly easier
Absolutely.
To get that documentation, because that's a lot.
That's
you know,
right.
That's hard to get sometimes.
That's
we
right.
struggle with that all the time. So we do have options available. That's what we're here for. If you're struggling, come to us, and more than likely we'll have something that can help you move forward.
Great.
Yeah.
If you have one message to give in the next minute, what is it?
Lead paint is way more prevalent than you think and way more dangerous than you think. And we have all of the tools at our disposal to help you make your home lead safe. Not just for you, but for your family, for anybody, for your children, for your grandchildren, for anybody. And particularly in places like Somerville, it's extremely important. And here we have this great program where you pay $250 out of pocket and you get a lead safe house. So in the long run, if you have any questions, any thoughts, any even thought of a possibility of lead in your house, give us a call and we'll help you make sure that it's lead safe if we can. So.
And how are they gonna call you?
Our phone number is 617-625-6600, extension 2577. You can just leave a message there. My direct line is extension 2588. So feel free to give me a call and I'll be glad to help you.
And I know another message is tell a friend. So even if this doesn't fit you, please ask your neighbor, talk to your friend, and if they need help with that, this is a great program. Danielle, I want to thank you. It's a very important topic, and there are so many children out there in Somerville that are eating those little chips, so let's make sure they're safe.
Thank you. It was a pleasure. Thanks for having me on, Cindy.
And until next month, have a great day.